Hi, welcome to the Nordic MTB channel. My name is Chris, and today we'll convert to tubeless tires. We'll do a how-to video, and we'll see what else you would possibly need as tools and equipment. And first off, I'll need to wash my bike. I'll put in some links so you can skip right to the position in the video that you would like to see, but of course I don't mind if you want to watch the whole thing. Enjoy! Well, this is what you need to get the job done. First off, essentials is a tubeless valve, some sealant. This is my choice. I usually run with the Stans raised sealant. You can also go with the standard one. This one might block up some punctures a bit more effectively. It has some bigger chunks of latex or whatnot in the mix, but also a little bit more expensive. Then you definitely need a pump. A compressor would be ideal. Next best thing, I guess, would be a floor pump. A hand pump usually doesn't cut it. Then nice to have a towel, paper. Then depending on your rim and tire combination, you might need tire levers, tubeless tape if the rim is not tubeless ready. This is proper tubeless tape. You could apparently also try with duct tape or Gorilla tape. I think I'll try it today and leave the Stans tape for another day. And then probably you'll need some cutting tools. And then for a trick to get the tire seated when we start pumping, some soapy water and a brush. They might come in handy, but we'll see. That's everything that I can think of now that I will need. Okay, so first off, we're gonna let some air out and try to get one of the tire beads loose or open. And before you start doing this, you want to check that your tire that you're installing or converting is tubeless ready. This one is Maxxis Minion DHF TR, so tubeless ready. Same goes for the wheels, that they are tubeless compatible. I have some WTB wheels here, and it clearly says that they are tubeless compatible. I know that these wheels do not have tubeless rim tape pre-installed, but some wheels might have, and that makes the whole process a lot easier. So we'll start to take some air out, remove the air cap, and maybe also the retaining. What do you call this? Bolt, retaining bolt, and then start to remove some air. I'm going to use a valve tool to open the valve core totally. This helps also when sealing the tubeless tire. You don't have to do it, but it helps. And in this case, with our tubeless valve set, they also shipped a valve core removal tool with it. I'll show you next.
Okay, so here we have a valve core removal tool, just a plastic clip with the right size hole in it. And this is a valve core. You simply put the tool over the core, it slots in nicely, and this gives you some leverage so you can open the valve core from the valve which is threaded in. So that's what we'll do now. We'll let the rest of the air come out by removing the core.
And now we'll take one of the beads off the wheel and remove the inner tire. I'll use my tire levers as help. You might not need one, but if you use one, please use a plastic one to not scratch your wheels. First off, it usually helps if you push the tire in to the center first, and you get it up loose nicely, and then just
I ran out of battery while installing the tape on the rim. It went smoothly. I didn't even need any scissors or anything. You can easily tear this tape in such a way that it just stays in its in the width that you use, and just put it on the rim, center it, and make sure that the glue sticks. Right on.
All right, the tape is on.
Next up, we'll need to punch a hole through the valve hole so that we can install the tubeless valve. I'm probably going to use the screwdriver here, but you can use a pointed thing. With the real thing, the tubeless tape, I did it in such a way that I heated up the head of the screwdriver glowing red and then poked through it carefully. The issue which I had with this stainless tape that was that it was prone to start cracking in a way. It's kind of a hard plastic. So if you don't heat it up, you might get a crack in the tape, which goes a few centimeters in the direction of the rim, which is not good. So I ended up replacing the tape and then doing it the hole properly. But we'll see how it goes with the duct tape. Okay, I located the hole and just gently pushed the screwdriver through it, and the hole looks pretty neat. And here's the valve. I'm gonna remove the cap. Go ahead and insert into the hole and screw the retaining bolts on again and screw it on pretty tight. While pressing down with a thumb on the valve and then screwing the retaining bolt on here on the valve so that you get a airtight seal. Okay. That's in. All right, and now we'll put the tire on. And the disc brake is on the left side. That means on the front wheel, this would be pointing now down the road, as you can see from this pattern as well. And the rotation sign on the tire here, it's gonna roll forwards. Okay, the first tire. It is almost on the rim. There's a little bit more to go, and that's usually the hardest part. Again, the way to go is to check that the bead is on the center of the rim, which is usually a bit deeper, all the way through, and then you start just stretching the tire. In this case, you can quite easily do it by hand. Sometimes you will need a tire lever. Now, I'm going to put some salty water on the beads to help the tire to inflate and jump up on the rim when we start to inflate the tire. Now, before adding the sealant, I'm going to start to put the second bead of the tire on the wheel. I'm going to leave the bottom unseated so that I can pour the sealant into the tire. You could also use a syringe to remove the valve core, and then use a syringe to push the sealant in. I don't have a syringe on me right now, so I'm going to do this the other way. Usually you want to shake these, maybe even hold them upside down, and then set in a good amount of sealant. In case you wonder how much you want to put in, and you don't use a syringe, so you don't know milliliters. One rule of thumb would be to approximate 4 spoke lengths of in, and carefully set the bead up and turn the tire so that I don't spill the sealant on the floor. Now that we have two beads on, the second one usually is a bit more tough to get on. This particular rim and tire angle was easy enough. Now I'm gonna remove the valve core and start pumping. Hoping for the best and starting to pump vigorously. It up to approximately 30 psi. You can hear a leak, maybe. So it's the valve here, but now I'm gonna slosh the sealant around. It stopped. So the valve hole is not fully airtight yet, but that's why we have the sealant in there to help with some small holes. All right, this wheel is done. We have the same tire on with the logos matching nicely with the valve here. It's holding air for now. What you want to do also, after you've got the tire seated, is to either go ride it straight away to get the sealant in all of the places. You can also leave it overnight, but with a bit higher pressure, maybe 30 psi or 35 as discussed. And then before you do that, make sure that you get the sealant everywhere on the tire and on the rim by sloshing it around and maybe even bouncing it on the floor a few times. And the next day or before you go riding, just double check your tire pressures and set them to a level that you feel good for you. I usually run 20 psi in the front and 26 in the back. This wheel is finished. We got lucky with the bead popping up, or then it's the soap trick which works. You might not be as lucky as I was with a floor pump. In such a case, you'll probably need a compressor or something else which can blow in a lot of air in a short amount of time to get the pop you want from the tire to hop on the rim. The key benefits of going tubeless. One benefit is that you can run lower pressures on your tires. You'll have the benefit of possibly lower rolling resistance, and more grip, and maybe even a more comfortable ride. Second, you'll get rid of the inert tube, which weighs a considerable amount. So your overall bike setup will be lighter, and the weight that you are removing is from a very critical part, and it's from the outer edges of your wheel. The third case would be reducing the amount of punctures. So when you don't have an inner tube that can burst, even if you hit a nail or get a puncture or a really sharp stick, you have the sealant in the tire which seals up quite efficiently some small holes in the tire, and you might not even notice that you had a puncture. And the second case of punctures is that you will get rid of snake bites, and that's when you hit something, a rock or a curb, so hard that you flat out the tire against the rim, and in these cases you usually get two marks on the inner tube or two holes resembling a snake bite. Next, I'll put this back on my bike and then probably go for a ride. Hope to see you next time, and go ride your bike. Bye.